Welcome to Wednesday's edition of Renew Plus. I'm Pastor Tony. Thanks for joining us again today. And we're going to get right back into our series entitled No Condemnation. And again, Romans chapter 8, verse 1, it says, there is therefore now, present tense reality, no condemnation. Zero, no trace of it, no condemnation to us who are in Christ Jesus. Boy, that's good news. And that's the centerpiece of the gospel. Now, let's look over. We're looking at the devices of our adversary. Because in this realm, we still have an adversary, an enemy that's working against us. He's trying to bring you under his dominion. He's trying to bring attacks against you. He's trying to bring oppression in your life. And as a believer, you can stand up and resist him. You do not have to accept that. And let me tell you something, all that stuff is not, a lot of man-made traditional religion has taught that, you know, God sends bad stuff into our life to teach us something or to deepen our piety. That is not true. Jesus answered that in John chapter 10, in verse number 10. He says, the thief, talking about the adversary, the who that we've been talking about, Satan, the devil, he comes only in order to steal, to kill, and to destroy. He said, but Jesus said, but I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. So we see what God's trying to bring into our life. God's trying to bring life and a life abundant in our life. But Satan is trying to steal, kill, and to destroy. Well, the thing is, he can't just show up in a believer's life and say, all right, I'm going to steal all your stuff. I'm going to kill you. I'm going to destroy your life. No, he has to have an entrance. He has to have a foothold in there. You know, 2 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse number 11 says that we are not to be ignorant of Satan's devices. See, that's why we're spending the time this week talking about these things. It's all coupled together in our series entitled No Condemnation. You have to know that there's no condemnation in your life. You have to know that you have been completely forgiven of all sin. That it is a finished work. You have to enter into that rest of God by faith and say, you know what? Satan, I don't know who you're talking to, but you're talking to the wrong person because my God, my heavenly Father, the righteous judge says that my redemption, my salvation is a complete finished work. So you can go peddle your goods somewhere else. And see, that's the way we ought to be. Now, a lot of people, they're afraid. They think, well, Satan, he's gonna come in there and really rack me up. No, he's going to rack you up if you don't know this. If you're ignorant of these things, if you're ignorant of his devices, he's going to eat your lunch and pop the bag, all right? And we've already talked about how he gets in to our life. First of all, this is over in Romans chapter 8. He says that he gets into our life, first of all, with a suggestive accusation. It's not that he's going to blow in off the scene and say, I accuse you. Normally, no. He's going to suggest things to you. You know, you think you are a Christian. You call yourself a Christian. You're doing this. You know, you're doing this over here. You're not doing enough here. Let me tell you something. He would accuse you if you spent 6 days a week fasting and praying all day long. He would accuse you. He would accuse you of not spending the seventh day fasting and praying. Because it's not just what you do, but if you're trusting in your own self and your own works, you know what? He's also going to always going to say, is it enough? He's always going to tell you it's never enough. Never enough. You got to do more. And of course, that's not the case. I've entered into the rest of the finished work of Jesus. Therefore, it is enough. So I can now pray. I can fast. I can give. I can go to church. I can read the word. Not because I have to finish an incomplete work of redemption and salvation, but just knowing that I can do it because I want to, because I love my Heavenly Father. I love Jesus. I can do it with the right motivation. All right? So let's look over to Colossians chapter 1. Colossians, the first chapter. And let's start with verse number 11. It says, strengthened with all might. Well, how much is that? All might. Strengthened with all might. I love that right there. It says, according to his glorious power, for all patience and long suffering with joy. I tell you, if you are continually receiving the strength of God, you know, and the joy of the Lord is our strength. If you're continually receiving that in your life, the enemy's going to have a hard time bringing you down. I can tell you. But you're not going to be receiving strength if you're being weakened by self-condemnation. And that's what this whole series is about right here, is to undo and to dig up that root of self-condemnation in your life. Because we want to be receiving the strength of God in our life. We want to be living a victorious life, an overcoming life. But verse number 12, it says, giving thanks to the Father, who has qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in the light. I want you to notice who qualified us. See, the enemy wants to bring accusation and self-condemnation into your life for the purpose of disqualifying you to yourself of all the inheritance that God has already given to us. But I want you to notice, this is not something that God's going to do. This is not something that happens after you die and go to heaven. No, this is something that happened 2,000 years ago when Jesus went to the cross and bore our shame, guilt, and condemnation on the cross, became sin for us. Why is that? Because God at that time considered Jesus' work enough, more sufficient. He put his stamp of approval on the finished work of Jesus. And you know what? At that point, he qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in the light. You do not have to qualify yourself anymore. God has already, past tense, qualified you, and that qualification comes because of who we are in Christ. Now notice in verse number 13, big verse right here. It says, God, same God, the one who's for us, he says, he has delivered us from the power of darkness and has conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of his love. Again, notice right here, this is past tense. The moment you were born again, you reach back to the crucifixion, burial, resurrection, ascension of Jesus, and everything he did for us and made that a reality in your life. God at that point delivered you. Your Father delivered you from the power, the authority of darkness. See, that the forces of darkness are the ones that are arrayed against us. That's your adversary. That's the one who's trying to bring you down. That's the one that's trying to dominate and defeat you and attack you in life. But notice that you've already been delivered, past tense, reality, delivered from all his power, the power of darkness, and God has already transferred you into the kingdom of the Son of his love. Boy, I love that. The Son of his love, the kingdom of the Son of his love. You're already in that kingdom. You've already been delivered out of that old kingdom of oppression. Oh, but I tell you what, that's shouting ground. Now, notice the next verse. All this goes together right here. The fact that we're strengthened, verse 11, that we are qualified by the Father to receive and be partakers of that inheritance, verse number 12, and then we are delivered from the powers of darkness, and we've been conveyed and transferred into the kingdom of God's dear Son. All that goes together with this verse right here, verse 14, in whom, in Christ, see, that's the same in Christ that we've been talking about, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sin. I want you to know it's all tied in with that reality right there. There's the centerpiece of the gospel. That's the centerpiece of our new covenant right there. The fact that we've been forgiven of all sin and we have redemption through the blood of Jesus. That's a reality. That's a now reality right now. And notice right there, that causes all these other things to be a reality. The fact that we've been forgiven of sin, the fact that we've been redeemed through Jesus' blood, that at that point, Satan lost his control over you. He lost his grip over you. He lost his dominion over you right there. You've already been, verse 13, delivered from his power, from his authority, and conveyed into the kingdom of God's dear Son. Verse 12, you've already been qualified. Why? Because you've been forgiven. You've been redeemed. Verse number 11, you've already been strengthened with all might according to his glorious power. Now see, this really, these verses right here tie exactly in with what Paul talked about. And let's go over there to Acts chapter 26. Acts chapter 26, he is standing before, the Roman court right here, and he is given a defense of his gospel. In fact, he is relaying his testimony. He's relaying the heavenly vision that he had received, that heavenly calling that he had gotten from God. And of course, Paul received by revelation all these things that we've been going over right here. The fact that we've been forgiven of sin, that there is no condemnation, delivered from the powers of darkness, translated into God's the kingdom of God's dear Son. We're strengthened continually, and we're qualified. All those things are because Paul received a revelation of behind the scenes of what happened in the death, burial, resurrection of Jesus. And notice he's conveying this. This one verse right here conveys exactly, is parallel to what we just read right there. Acts chapter 26, verse 18, it says, this is his calling. This is our calling. This is my calling. He said to open their eyes, to open the eyes of the people, the unbelievers, the Gentiles, all of us, to open our eyes, not these eyes, but the eyes of your heart, in order to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and an inheritance among those who are sanctified by faith in me. I want you to see that right there. It goes in order. You know, the only thing that's keeping people from receiving Jesus and being born again is the fact that they're blinded. Satan has them blinded. The god of this world, 2 Corinthians 4:4 says, has blinded their minds. He's blinded their minds through, you know, man-made religion and pride, personal pride, in the fact that we can earn this, we can do this ourselves. No, you can't. That's what the law was given for, to bring you to the end of self so you could accept God's plan, God's method, his work of salvation as a finished work. He said to open their eyes. That's what needs to happen, to bring them out, turn them from darkness, from deception, from blindness, to the light of truth and revelation of the truth, and from the power of Satan to God. Notice what happens there. When people's eyes of their heart are enlightened, what happens? They turn from the power of Satan to God. They turn from the power of Satan to God. They are delivered from the power of Satan, that they may receive the forgiveness of sin. Not that God is going to forgive them at this point. God's already provided forgiveness of their sin through the blood, through the finished work of Jesus. But notice, they come to a place then of seeing the reality of this, and they receive by faith the forgiveness of their sins. And notice, and an inheritance among all those who are sanctified by faith in me. Notice that once that we receive the forgiveness of sin, then we are qualified, then we receive our qualification from God in order to receive and walk and be a partaker of our inheritance. I tell you, that is awesome. Boy, that is just good news. What's included in that inheritance? Anything and everything. It's the whole kingdom of God. It's everything that you will have need of in life. Any need that you're going to have in life has already been made and provided for by our Heavenly Father and His kingdom. And it is in our inheritance, and we are qualified to be a partaker of that inheritance. Man, that's all the time I've got for today. I wish we could keep going. We'll continue here tomorrow, by the way. If you'd like additional resources and materials, go to tonycowan.org, and we will see you tomorrow.